Good morning, everyone. I think we're going to move from consumers to explorers. After all, we're going to talk about being limitless. How many of you flew into the event today? Quite a few. So do you know how high you fly when you are in a jetliner? You're flying at about 11 kilometers from the Earth. So today we'll go much higher than that. I'll start my talk with three videos. The idea is to stretch your imagination. You know, imagination is a scarce resource. And what we'll do, the first video will give you an idea of how people like me, we are just a handful in the world, how do we go about visualizing future exploration systems? How do we go about designing them? So the first video will show you a rover that my Vienna company designed, which can carry a crew of 4 astronauts on long-distance sorties on Moon and Mars. The second video will show you how we test what we design, what we build, in what we call analogous environments. If I design something for the Moon, I would take it underwater to simulate 1/6 gravity. If I design something for Mars, I would take it, say, to Rio Tinto in Spain or Lanzarote, where the terrain is a bit Mars-like. And if I design something for low Earth orbit, to be in microgravity, I could even take it to extreme environments like Antarctica. So the second video will show you a greenhouse that we designed with the German Space Agency, which is currently in Antarctica being tested and eventually will be up on the space station. The third video will do exactly what I just mentioned. It will take you to about 400 kilometers from the Earth, and you will see what the astronauts see from the space station. So can we get started with the videos? This is the Moon, guys. There is no atmosphere. Everything is black and white and gray. That's Mars for you. And this is real imagery from NASA's rovers, Spirit and Opportunity. For the science fiction fans out there in the audience, The Rama Chronicles was written by Arthur C. Clarke, the British science fiction writer. That's what we named the rover on. This little bubble will carry 4 astronauts for up to a week on Moon and Mars and whichever planets we explore. It's a really small bubble. Imagine 4 of you in there for a week. One of the toughest things that we design for is how do you deal with micro compact spaces? How do you ensure that the astronauts don't go crazy? Because there will be psychological issues, there will be micro society issues. It's not just about technology, it's about making sure whoever goes out there can keep a sanity, be happy, and live as a team and work as a team. That's the challenge. So a lot of things we design are retractable, collapsible, stackable, deployable. So very, very transformative. In fact, living on a compact spaceship is very similar to living on extreme cities on Earth, like Bombay or Tokyo or Sao Paulo or New York, where you have similar challenges. This video is going to show you a greenhouse that we designed, which was transported to Antarctica, and it's currently in Antarctica being tested. This particular video doesn't have sound, but it has this fantastic landscapes that you see when you're out there. In fact, going to Antarctica in some ways is like being on another planet, if you ask me. It's a mind-bending experience. You become completely disoriented in terms of the landscape, the time, what have you. You see the German station Normaya in the background. So typically, anything that we design as a future system, it takes about 3 years to do the full design, which includes systems engineering, architecture, human factors, and about 3 years to sort of completely prototype something like this. And then you take it out and test it before you send it up in space. For those of you who haven't been to Antarctica or are planning to go to Antarctica, if you go there after March, April, you don't come back. You winter over, because that's the autumn in Antarctica. It's the southern hemisphere. So many of you these days are familiar with hydroponics, growing things using water nutrients. How many of you eat microgreens, for example? There are organic farmers, there are IT engineers who are leaving their jobs and setting up hydroponic farms. It's very similar. In fact, there are a lot of reciprocities between living here on Earth and living in outer space, because, guys, we forget. We are living on a spaceship. We are hurtling through space right this very moment. We forget it. So I think it's sort of a great reminder. This is one of the Normaya scientists going over to the greenhouse, which is away from the base station. So this is possible. I think we have the technology such that when astronauts say go to Mars, it takes 6 months to get there, right? And once you are there, you have to stay there for about 520 days before you can come back. There's a certain launch window. So it's very important that astronauts be able to grow their own produce and not have to carry everything from here. So greenhouses are going to become an important part of long-distance planetary missions in the future. Can we go on to the next video, please? So now we are levitating ourselves up to the space station. The soundtrack is by Howard Blake, Walking on Air. How many of you have been to the poles, to the Arctic, for example? So you can see the green lights here, right? I mean, it's a very psychedelic experience if you're there with the swirling green lights, but you can see it at the horizon. And again, it's a reminder, we are on that blue spaceship, guys, don't forget. You can see the space station solar panels kind of floating in the background, in the foreground. And you can see a couple of modules of the space station, the Japanese module and the node. Even this is a bit psychedelic, if you ask me. If you look carefully, you will see the moon show up. And look at the light pollution on our planet. It's pretty exciting to sort of land into Los Angeles or Bombay, but this is excessive amounts of light pollution. To see our planet is to go to the moon, and that's the moon for you. And you see the atmospheric blanket is so thin, it's almost translucent, it's fragile. We forget that is what keeps us alive on this planet. The atmosphere and the what we call the magnetic radiation belts, the Van Allen belts, which protects us from the harmful rays of the sun, the galactic radiation. We take everything for granted, right? We take gravity for granted. We take atmospheric pressure for granted. We even take natural illumination for granted. So I think what excites me about being a designer who thinks about how do we live off the planet is that in those environments, you can't take any of this for granted. Okay, this is my special moment here. You will see the Comet Lovejoy make an appearance, which is just spectacular. You see the comets with the tail. I think all of you should get out of your cities every now and then, sleep under the sky, and look at what's up there and what's out there. In fact, we are all astronauts, you know. We actually are living on a planet. We always think you have to go to outer space to be an astronaut, but actually, I personally feel we are astronauts already because we're living on one. Thank you very much. So today, I mean, we're going to be limitless, right? So I'm going to talk to you about exploration and the way I'll start with a small trajectory of my own personal life to show you how I got into this. And then I'll talk about my three companies, my little orbital enterprise, where I try to blur the boundaries between science fiction and reality. And then we will end with our take on the planet and the future of the planet. So this is a cheeky juxtaposition. It's sort of a bit of time travel. It was taken around the same time in 1972. So that's me in my Earth buggy. By the way, the strollers of today don't compare to the buggies we had back then. You know, you could actually move and you could explore. And on the right is Eugene Cernan, who was part of the last Apollo landing in December of 1972. I think that's another very important thing to me, is that we are all born explorers. But what happens is the kind of parenting you do decides what you end up doing, right? A lot of parents usually take the push-to-perform approach to bringing up kids. I think more of them should sort of go for the dare-to-dream. Let your kids be free. Let them explore. Don't put them into a job-seeking mentality. And a very important thing is sort of a gender-neutral approach to toys, to your curriculum in schools. It's very important. You know, even girls can play with binoculars and cameras and trucks. It doesn't have to be one or the other. It's very important. So growing up, the two biggest influences in my life were space and architecture. So what you see here is a beautiful photograph of a rocket cone being transported on a bicycle in Thumba, in Kerala, in 1963. So India made its first experiment launch in 1963. And the photograph is taken by the French photographer Henri Cartier-Bresson, who used to spend a lot of time in India. And on the right side, what you see is a TV grab of the first Apollo landing. My dad used to live in Canada then, and I grew up watching slides of, you know, things like the Apollo landing. I think it's also important for us to understand that it is not just about science and technology. We give too much importance to science and technology. It's also the right side of our brain. So we need to kind of focus on both sides of our brain. And that's the kind of upbringing I had growing up with the pioneers of the Indian space program. So my dad was one of the first recruits. And the pioneers are always different from those who are running it today. They're more like bureaucrats. I could talk to them about art, about architecture, about design, about politics. And they were Renaissance men, and that's really what shaped me. Every morning in Ahmedabad, where I grew up, when I would open the windows of my study, my bedroom, I used to wake up to Doshi's vault architecture. How many of you are aware of Doshi? He got the Pritzker Award last year. He's in his 90s, and Pritzker is like the Nobel Prize in architecture. So I was very fortunate to grow up among architects, the kids of architects, and the patrons of architecture. So Ahmedabad, being a textile city, it has cotton mill owner families, right? The Sarabhais, the Lalbhais, the Hathi Singhs. So not only did they commission amazing contemporary architects to design their residences, but also public institutions. So if you put space and architecture together, what do you have? Space architecture. So space architecture is an invented discipline. There was no such thing as space architecture, right? It took us 20 years to make space architecture a recognized discipline, a recognized professional discipline in the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, because the engineers were not willing to recognize us as such. Here is a shot, a beautiful shot of the space shuttle Atlantis docked to the Russian space station Mir. I began my professional journey with a brief stint at NASA Johnson in Houston. Right outside my office window, I could actually see the prototype of a Saturn V rocket on the grass. I mean, it was a beautiful view outside my window. And I worked on many of the shuttle Mir projects. I trained for parabolic flights. I was part of tests where they were trying to see how good are women and men when it comes to docking stations. Pretty similar, guys. How easy or difficult is it to take a shower in space? Is it even a good idea? I also looked at what we call astronaut debriefs for four of the docking missions where shuttle and Mir docked. And I had to compare the reactions of astronauts who were there for 5 to 7 days during the docking and the long-duration American astronauts who spent 4 months and 6 months on Mir. It was a fascinating view into their world. And so I looked at food and sleep systems and hygiene and odor, air quality, all of that. My favorite chapter was on odors. So an American astronaut would tell you, oh, Mir smelled like my attic. Someone else would say, oh, Mir smelled like piney woods or a shipbuilding yard. And one of them even said, oh, Mir smelled like Russia. So I think odor is again, a very important sensory thing. And when you go into space, your taste buds change, your perception of distances and up and down changes, even odors. You become very sensitive to that. After that, I worked for the Boeing company in Huntington Beach in Southern California for the International Space Station program. So when they originally, this is 1998, when the first module of the space station was launched, the budget for the space station initially was $17.4 billion. And after they crossed the 100 billion mark, they stopped counting. What you see here is the complete space station, and it's sort of the size of 2 football fields. It's pretty massive. And that's where you were flying with the Howard Blake video, right? That's the altitude you were flying. With the space station, being a foreign national and being on a site where they make Delta rockets, by the way, I was the only foreign national on that defense site, it's nearly impossible for a foreign national to work at, say, even a company like Boeing. So they really went out of their way to have me. It took them 15 months to go through all the hoops to have me there. I was working in international business development, which in a way was a sort of an interesting experience for me because I was part of a small team that was making money for the program as opposed to spending money. And so what that meant is bid and proposal, negotiations, selling things to other countries that were part of the program. And we were selling anything from, say, a space-qualified fire extinguisher to an entire module. So it was, for a young person like me, it was a great experience seeing how that cycle happens. So I was with them for 3 years, and then things start to get repetitive, right? And the kind of person I am, I get bored pretty easily, so I decided it's time to leave and start my first company. So I was 29, and I decided to leave Boeing, and I was looking to move to a walkable city. And in the US, you have only so many walkable cities. So I chose to move to San Francisco, and I launched my first company called Moonfront. It was a small partnership, 6 partners. And for me, being a first-generation entrepreneur, it was a learning experience. We worked on very many diverse projects. Here you're seeing a future moon base. We did a fantastic workshop in Europe where students from very many European countries came together and we tried to design future moon bases. This is a combination. You see solid parts and inflatable parts. That's part of the system. As part of Moonfront, we put NASA on Second Life. We organized a fantastic party in the Playboy Mansion grounds in Los Angeles to celebrate the 21st century, the arrival of 2001, the Space Odyssey. How many of you have seen the movie, The Space Odyssey? So Tom Hanks and Morgan Freeman and Patrick Swayze, you know, part of Star Trek, everybody showed up for the party. And we beamed Arthur C. Clarke as a 3D hologram to the Playboy Mansion. So, you know, being an entrepreneur, the hard part is how do you make sure you get paid every 2 weeks or every month, but you get to do amazing things, right? This is my second company, which I started 4 years later in Vienna, in Austria. How many of you have been to Vienna? Okay, because often when I say Austria, people think it's Australia. I'm like, no, it's Mozart, not kangaroos. It's two different countries. So everybody was surprised, why would you start a company in Vienna? They are not into human spaceflight. But each of my companies, I've started it with friends of mine. And people who are entrepreneurs or who are into business, they'll often tell you that think twice before you start a company with a friend. You might not end up being friends, you know, in the long term. Things can go wrong. But luckily, all of my companies, we're still friends, we have differences, and we are doing wonderfully well. My Vienna company turns 15 this year, so it's our 15th anniversary. And starting a space company is very different from starting an IT company, for example. You know, for space companies like ours, we design, we build, we fly, we test. So it takes a good 5-7 years to say, okay, I've now reached cruise altitude. You know, even if we break even after 7 years, it's great. It's really not about profit for us. It's at least for someone like me, I'm more of a passionpreneur than an entrepreneur. You know, it's the joy I get out of these things, no profits can match it. What you're seeing here is a habitat for two astronauts, which is designed in such a way that it can collapse, it can sort of become smaller, it can ride on the top of an Ariane rocket, and when it gets to the planetary surface, you can deploy it back. So what that means is designers like us, we take a lot of inspiration from nature, you know, whether it's jellyfish or spiders or flowers. So we call it biomimicry. And how do you make things compact and fly and transport, and then you deploy it? This particular habitat, the prototype is sitting in what we call a high bay in the International Space University in France. I've studied and lived in very many different countries, guys. So the Space University is a high bay where this is like a garage. Think of it like a garage with a high roof. And it can be transported on lorries in Europe so that it can be taken to Spain or some other country for simulation testing or for exhibition. So it's amazing how you have to design things for Earth transportation and for space transportation. Very interesting thing you'll see is the astronaut, the backpack, he latches it onto the outside of the habitat, and he has to wiggle out into the habitat, leaving his suit outside. It's a very important part of designing future spacesuits because you don't want to bring the dust inside the habitat. You want to leave the dust out. So we're also thinking about dust showers and things like that. Dust is a big problem, whether you're on Mars, on Moon, wherever. I moved back to India in 2008. And like I said, I was born in the early 70s. I grew up with the pioneers of the Indian space program. So I've seen it evolve, right? When I came back in 2008, I looked around and I wanted to see what is it that I want to do now that I'm back? I wanted to do something for India, but what should I do? So I went and met with the guys who had already started working on the human space program. I looked at our satellites, our rockets, and I fell in love with the PSLV. So any country which is launch capable, there are 7 countries in the world that can launch things into space. India is one of them. Every launch-capable country has 2 rockets. One that takes you to about 1,000 kilometers, and it's usually remote sensing, Earth observation satellites, spy satellites, weather satellites. And the other one is the heavy lifter, the GSLV, which takes you to 36,000 kilometers. Imagine, guys, 36,000 kilometers over the equator for communication satellites. Anyway, I was smitten by the PSLV, the little guy. The PSLV first flew in 1993. I came back in 2008, right? And to me, it's a very reliable very mature rocket in its class. So I thought, okay, how can I, as an international entrepreneur, leverage my friendships and my connections and make the PSLV the most sought-after rocket in its class in the world? So I looked at what are the foreign payloads we launched on the PSLV until 2008. One of my interns added up all the mass of foreign payloads, and it was roughly 1,500 kilograms. In 10 years, we had launched 1,500 kilograms of foreign payloads. And one PSLV can carry about 1,600 kilograms. And I thought this was way too modest. I mean, how are we going to be the world leader if you only launch less than one PSLV equivalent in 10 years? So then I saw that the Europeans come to ISRO because we have great bilateral relations. They get subsidies. It's all good. But if you want to be a world leader, we need to be launching American satellites. That's the biggest market. The American market was close to India because of a 1998 embargo. How many of you remember the nuclear tests in 1998, right? So the embargo still exists. It's a 20-year-old embargo, but it still exists. It's the US playing big brother, right? So the American companies under the embargo are not allowed to sell space components to India. So if you can't sell space components, how can you fly an American satellite on an Indian rocket? A rocket, after all, is a missile. Impossible, right? So I thought that's going to be my next Mission Impossible that I take on with my new company. It took me 3 years. I met with 14 diplomats in Washington, D.C. and Delhi over 3 years. My first launch client was a company, a Stanford startup called Skybox. They were a startup. Earth to Orbit was a startup. We had nothing to lose, right? So I would go to meet these diplomats over tea, over coffee. What I would call that soft diplomacy, because the countries were not willing to come to the negotiating table for obvious reasons, right? So I got asked if you're an American spy, if you're an Indian spy, you know, why are you doing this? How many of you have seen the Spielberg movie Bridge of Spies? Okay, some of you, yes. There's a scene in there where Tom Hanks is sitting with the Russian consul in East Berlin, and over drinks he says, let's talk about things that our countries cannot. That's what I did over 3 years. And finally, the US State Department gave us the first ever waiver to override the ban to allow us to fly the Skybox satellite on the PSLV. It took yet another year. By the way, bureaucracy is everywhere. It's just different in different countries. It took us another year to get all the signatures on both sides. And yet another year to have a launch agreement signed between ISRO and Skybox. 5 years, right? I mean, this is like bringing down a mini Berlin Wall, if I may say. It's not easy, but it can be done. So when you see the PSLV launching 104 satellites, which is amazing choreography if you think about it, 96 are American satellites. And yes, the PSLV is one of the most sought-after rockets in its class in the world today. So that was one part of the mission. And we also, I wanted to bring the Japanese to launch. So we launched a Japanese satellite on the PSLV too. So that's what I did with Earth to Orbit the first 7 years. But the plan was not to be in the launch arbitrage business. It was, see, the reason I became an entrepreneur was very clear, two reasons. One, if you work for a space agency or a company, you can't speak your mind, right? So you have to be outside the system to say what you think. The second was to challenge the status quo, right? To change the world. You can't do that if you're just working for someone. So I think my reasons to be an entrepreneur are very different from those who want to do an IPO or have exit strategies. I have no exit strategy. I'm in it for life. I love this. The next company, well, I think what I love about this photograph is that this picture went viral. Social media, we live in the world of social media. This is a photograph from Mission Control in Bangalore after Mangalyaan arrived in the Mars orbit. So everybody around the world just woke up and said, oh my goodness, you went to Mars on the first attempt and you're women working? You know the kind of stereotypes that are sold about India around the world. And guess what? Not only do we have women in silk saris with flowers in their hair celebrating the arrival on Mars, ISRO has the best gender ratio in the world when it comes to space agencies. 12% are women. And this has been the case from the early 70s. It's nothing new. We have had women head rocket programs, satellite programs. We have a woman heading the human space program. So for us, it's normal. You know, I'm a woman. I'm the only person in the world to have started companies on three different continents, and I'm from India. So I think this kind of stereotype, I think the space programming is also helping the world wake up to India, which I love. This is a beautiful photograph of one of our crew capsules, which is after the splashdown in the Bay of Bengal. So you launch the capsule, it goes around the Earth for about 12 days, and then you either come and have a hard landing on the ground, like the Russians, or you splash down in the water like the Apollo guys, right? So we have chosen a splashdown mode for our capsule, and we have tested a capsule twice already. What is unfortunate is ISRO doesn't share all this with us. Do you even know that we've tested a crew capsule twice? We don't. There's practically no PR, so we need to change that. This is a picture which was released a couple of days ago. What you see is the lunar lander called Vikram, and a little rover. Can you see a rover on the ramp? So this contraption is going to fly on the 15th of July to the moon. And it's supposed to land around September 6th. So any of you who've never seen a rocket launch, I highly encourage you. You should sign up, go to Sriharikota. Even if you can't get inside the launch pad, stand outside and see it go up. You know, when you hear a rocket boom, the sound boom, there's nothing like it. I mean, watching on TV just doesn't do it. So if you're in Chennai, or even if you're really a space crazy person, just go over to Sriharikota and watch the launch live. I highly recommend, it's coming up on the 15th. And this is sort of a snapshot of the future. 3D printing, we all know, is going to revolutionize the way we design things, the way we build things. For now, what we have to do is what we call piecemeal architecture. You have to keep building a thing piecemeal. You keep going, you know, taking more and more rocket flights. But here, what we are trying to imagine, and we are already working on it, is how can we use the local materials, in-situ materials, and use the regolith on the moon, on Mars, and build using that, right? So this is a concept that was generated by my Vienna company and the European Astronaut Center, which won one of the NASA Grand Challenges. And we are already testing with lunar regolith kind of material to see how we can use lava casting and sintering techniques to build small parts. We're already doing that. And whatever we design, like the very first video you saw, the first thing we do after we design it is we spit it out as a 3D model. It's very easy to do that these days. We have a printer right in our office. And this, I'm sort of bringing you back to our planet and the realities here. I mean, this photograph says everything that I want to say to every one of you in the room, to not forget that what kind of separates exploration and exploitation is a very thin line. You know, I went to Antarctica in 2017. I was invited to be part of the first ever cultural expedition. There are a lot of scientific expeditions to the icy continent. So I sailed with about 20 artists from around the world and about 10 interdisciplinary experts like myself. So I have degrees in everything, engineering, architecture, industrial design, space, because I think we can't think only in silos. We have to be multidisciplinary. We were on one of the islands, one of the landings. We had these massive, rusty silos. And this was the Deception Island. It's a dormant volcano. And you know what the silos were? The explorers in the past had wiped out the seal population in that island, and those silos were used to store seal blubber. So whether it's whale blubber or seal blubber, even the Royal Geographical Society that used to fund those expeditions, if you think about it. Colonization was sort of part of the exploration mission statement. You know, Livingstone, after he arrived in Africa, within 10 years, 50% of Africa was colonized. So remember, I think when Musk uses words like, let's colonize Mars, my response is very simple. We really need to be careful with the vocabulary and how we approach the exploration of other planets. If we colonize Mars the way we colonized on Earth, it's not going to be a pretty picture. It's going to end up like this, and I think it's very worrisome. And I will leave you with this beautiful image of an iceberg in Antarctica. And I want all of you, whether it's your lifestyles, your businesses, to think of what is the final impact on your planet. Abhinay has left, but I don't do e-commerce. Once I'm back in India, I don't buy fast fashion anymore. So I think, I'm not saying we should shut down businesses, but I think we have to bring it into our thinking that even if I am an e-commerce business, how can I bring down the carbon footprint? And there are ways to do it. It's really doable. I'll sort of wrap up with an anecdote. One of the landings we had in Antarctica, we were on Paradise, in Paradise Bay, and we decided that for 30 minutes, we will just sit there in perfect silence, all of us, artists and us. And there was a point where you heard this loud explosion. It was as if a skyscraper was being detonated, that kind of loud explosion. And guess what it was? It was an iceberg calving, an iceberg breaking up. And Antarctica has about 5 to 7 ice shelves. By the way, it's not only happening there, it's happening in the Himalayas, in the Alps, in Greenland, everywhere. And if Antarctica melts, the ocean levels around the world, it'll rise by a sort of the equivalent of a 20-story building, guys, which means all our coastal cities will be gone. Chennai, San Francisco, doesn't matter, Sydney, they'll be all underwater. And I think, I'm a diehard optimist, but I do think what we humans have done to our planet, maybe in another 3 to 4, maximum 5 generations, one generation is up to about 15 years, the Earth is not going to be habitable anymore. So what are we talking about? Our bottom lines. Will we even leave a planet for the future generations? I think I'll leave you with that thinking. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any, I don't know, musings? Yes.
Need the mic, yeah.
Yeah. You're talking about setting up stations across the universe.
And, not that many, but yes.
I'm imagining.
Yes, we are already in low Earth orbit, and we are planning to, yes, absolutely.
So let my imagination go wild.
Yes, absolutely. Go ahead.
So one of the things that I found very interesting is being a part of the luxury space. I attend some of the fairs, and I found that just the way we use the gems that we find in Mother Earth and adorn ourselves, some of the watch companies have been using meteorites and rocks that come from the moon. Is there any way in which you can get access to things like this?
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, if you go on the internet, you will find companies that are already talking about asteroid mining. There are companies that want to go out and bring back resources to our planet. To be honest, at this point, it's fairly speculative. I think one of the business, the pitches is that we will bring back platinum-based metals back to Earth. The Japanese are the only ones who've actually done an asteroid sample return mission. It's called Hayabusa. So everybody else is talking about it. The Japanese have actually done it. I think the other way, in fact, when Konstantin was showing one of his slides, you know, where he showed some of your minerals where you could touch and Instagram, you know, all of that. I think when you look at moon rocks or any of these asteroid samples, they all look very similar. And I don't know about precious metals, but yes, there are a lot of resources, which is why it's going to probably be the next Wild Wild West, right? And it is going to happen. People are already talking about it. How soon can we get back, certain elements from the moon, for example? I think helium-3 is one of the forerunners. If you're able to extract helium-3 from the moon and bring it back to Earth, that will be quite an accomplishment. But I don't think precious metals yet, but I think that's the pitch everybody wants to sell to investors. And by the way, Luxembourg, which is a thimble of a country, has already declared itself the legal and financial haven for all space resource mining companies. So if you want to go out prospecting, set it up in Luxembourg. They are the Bahamas for the future of space resource mining. It's coming. I'm sure there will be that.
Susmita, I'm here. Just...
Yes.
I hate to ask this question, but I'm asking it from the point of view of information and sustainabilities. All your projects are very intensive, although I know a project in Bangalore where they're building this rover kind of thing to get to the moon.
Team Indus.
I'm involved with Team Indus,
I know them with, before they started. Yes.
With crowdfunding. Now, in a situation like yours that's doing space, how do you get funding for this? I hate to put money into this conversation.
I love the question. I think it's a very real question for me and for anybody who wants to start a space company. So, for example, the Vienna company, which is... been around for 15 years now. My San Francisco company, we dissolved it when I moved back. The initial 5 to 6 years, our fundings came from open bids, where we would bid for contracts competitively within the European Space Agency group of countries and win bids and work on projects. The second half of our life cycle, a lot of our funding in Europe comes from the European Commission, which puts out almost 60 to 70 billion euros every 2 to 3 years under the European Commission to fund innovation and research. So the reality is you don't have paying customers out there yet. So we are sort of depending on research grants and public taxpayer money. And in the US, you have something called the Small Business Innovation Research Program, where in the first phase, where you have to prove the feasibility of an idea, you get up to $100,000. And you can get up to $500,000 to commercialize the idea. Unfortunately, in India, we don't have any such funding mechanisms yet, so to speak, which is why we often fly in an empty tank. My revenues came from my clients abroad. So we don't have it yet, but people like me and the other entrepreneurs, Team Indus and others, we're trying to lobby for a mindset overhaul first. Because the people who run ISRO today, they need to have this mind shift where they should not see us as competitors, but as allies. It hasn't happened, but I'm sure it's going to happen. I think it's slowly, it's a negotiation thing, right, over time. And I think Team Indus, again, now that we've mentioned Team Indus, I have to say, I mean, I've been involved in helping them from the outside ever since they registered. How many are aware of the Google Lunar X Prize? So it was a $30 million prize for the first private team who could build a lunar lander, land it, get a rover out, drive it for about 500 meters, and send imagery back. Nobody won the prize. The deadline came and went. Team Indus was one of 26 teams, and it was in the top three. And I say this with a heavy heart, but I think India scuttled Team Indus. Both ISRO and the Prime Minister, in my view, and I'm saying it in an open forum, did not want to see a private team of young people make it to the moon before ISRO did. So in the top three teams, there was an Israeli team which went and crash-landed. It's called Bereshit. And Netanyahu was there in mission control. So Israel supported its team, which was in the top three. But we did not support our team, which was in the top three and could have made it to the moon sooner. But I think that's where I'm saying we need a mind shift. You know, it's unfortunate. We still have that mentality of a, you know, like an overprotective parent. ISRO is one of the finest organizations we have. In fact, there is more innovation happening in ISRO than in the IT industry, which brings back 50 billion or whatever in export dollars. If ISRO were to privatize and commercialize, then we would be creating hundreds of thousands of new jobs, and 50 billion is nothing. We would be bringing back a lot more, and I think we, as in the space milieu in Bangalore, are trying to push for that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
One last question, then we need to move on.
I'll be here so we can talk over lunch. I'm not flying away after this.
Not yet. You talked about exploitation and exploration. And you left us with a sort of gloomy look into the future. And I'm just wondering, in this exploration, what is exploitable for us to be able to save what we're doing to the planet today?
So you want a planet perspective as opposed to going out there perspective. I think there is a lot that each one of us is doing on a daily basis to destroy this planet. So I think for all of us, one of the things I tell young people to do is spend 30 minutes every day just quietly contemplating who you are, what you're doing, because we are so busy looking at our phones all day long, we don't realize. So everything from what you're wearing to what you're eating, you said eye drops using Amazon. So me and my husband are exact opposites. I don't buy much e-commerce simply because I think packaging that comes with it. I've lived in California for 12 years. I've lived in Sweden, in France. I think e-commerce needs to take responsibility for packaging. So like Big Basket is delivering vegetables but bringing the basket back, right? There are laws in countries like Germany where if you're a Samsung, if you're selling refrigerators, you take your packaging back to your country, right? Similarly, fast fashion, what we wear. In India, you can go to a tailor. This is stitched by a tailor. Why should I buy fast fashion, which is the second most polluting industry after oil and gas? Can I walk? Yes, I can walk. Can I bicycle? I still bicycle. I mean, look at me. So I think, coming back to your question, Constantine, I think we as individuals, we as companies, I like the fact that we have water in bottles today, no plastic bottles. These are very small steps, but it all adds up. So I think we have reached a point in our industrial revolution where we need to go back. You know, the natives who were colonized in Hawaii or in Australia or in India, they lived in harmony with nature. They had closed, what we in spaceship design call closed loop systems or near closed loop. Even our grandparents did. If you look at my grandfather's house in Odisha, everything was closed loop. The trash didn't even have to leave the system. It was composted, there was minimum trash, and the pond had the fish to clean up the water. So I think we need to go back. I think we need to slow down. I think we need to pause and we need to think. We don't use our brains enough. We're always on apps. And yes, I think we can't reverse it, but we can live a much healthier life for ourselves and our planet. We really can, but we need to take the time to dissect our lives, our companies, and take those steps. It's doable. It is doable. So I don't want to shock you guys. I just want you to wake up and do things differently tomorrow when you leave this place. That's all.
One question.
Thanks very much.
One last question.
Thank you again.
Last question on.
Make it short, please, because we're running a bit late.
We can also talk over lunch.
Okay. As one of the speakers said, that it's a luxury to... Luxury has become an experience now. So I'm talking about the luxury that if we move to the Antarctica or move to the space, how does it affect the health of the people?
I think luxury, let's talk about luxury. My definition of luxury, I like your question. I might not answer it directly, we'll talk, but I think to me, growing up, I used to go to the Sarabhai residence a lot. You know, Sarabhais are the ones who had textile mill families, businesses, and they started the space program. So in Anand Sarabhai's house, every day, the soap was put on a fresh leaf every day, right? To me, that is luxury. That is, it's a leaf from your garden, a fresh leaf every day, and you move the soap to that. I think we also need to redefine luxury, guys. But I'll leave you with that. We'll talk at lunch. I will not take any more of your time. Redefine luxury. I mean, even within your own space. Thank you.